This video contains everything you need to know if you want to get into some of the world's top PhD programs. I myself am a PhD candidate at MIT, but everything I'll tell you applies to all top schools such as Harvard, Stanford, Berkeley, Caltech, etc. The application procedures at the best European universities are quite different, but the tips that I will give you still mostly apply. I recently made a video about how to get into MIT for your undergraduate studies, which was specific for international students. This video though is general because, at least in theory, for PhD admissions it doesn't matter if you're from the US or not. I'm going to explain in a moment why I say in theory. Before I dive into all the tips and tricks of how to get into these best PhD programs, I want you to first ask yourself, does it actually make sense for you to do a PhD? Doing a PhD may or may not be net beneficial for your career, so make sure to first do your research. Also, think about whether or not it actually makes sense for you to directly apply for a PhD out of your undergraduate studies, or if you should maybe wait for a year or two and get some work experience. Work experience, yeah. If you're not 100% sure that you want to do research, I definitely recommend the latter. You can always come back at a later point and do a PhD. Feel free to ask me about this in the comment section down below so I can give you a more individualized response. Okay, so let's assume that you have decided to go ahead and apply to either MIT or any other top school for your PhD. Contrary to undergraduate applications, which are handled by the university's central admission department, PhD applications are handled directly by the department you apply to. For example, in my case, this was the MIT Department of Electrical Engineering and Computer Science. Usually, applications are due sometime in December and all programs start around September 1st. That is probably the key difference between US PhD programs and European PhD programs. In Europe, you can often start anytime you want, you just have to convince a professor that they should hire you. For example, a good friend of mine, she reached out to a professor at ETH Zurich. He was very convinced with her and she started working and doing her PhD just 2 weeks later. In the US, forget about this. You have to apply almost 10 months in advance before your PhD program starts. There are three major ways to get admitted to MIT PhD programs. The first and most difficult way is just submitting your application and hoping for the best. The second and slightly easier way of getting admitted to MIT is already knowing some professor there and then have them give your application a little push to get you admitted. That was a bit weird. If you already study somewhere in the US, your professors that you're working with are more likely to have good connections to MIT or some other top university, and therefore, in practice, living in the US might give you a slight advantage in your application. The third, and also slightly easier way of getting admitted is already doing something at MIT, like doing an internship there or some kind of research project, and then you can use these connections that you made in order to convince some professors to get you admitted. Either way, whichever method you use, you will still have to submit your application just like everyone else. I personally have experienced all three methods, each at a different university, so I'm going to talk about them in more detail. I got admitted to MIT through method number one. I just submitted my application, I didn't know anyone in the department that I applied to, and well, 3 months later, I got admitted. Next up, when it comes to method number two, my advisor in Switzerland used to be a professor in Stanford prior to moving to EPFL, so he put me in touch with some of his colleagues there. And obviously, needless to say, he put in a good word for me, which surely helped. This obviously put me into a great position. I was even invited to give a talk at Stanford before submitting my application. Sadly, in the end, there was just no overlap with the research interest between me and the different Stanford professors, so my application didn't work out. And lastly, when it comes to method number three, I wrote my entire master thesis at Harvard University, so I could have just stayed there and continued as a PhD candidate. Based on my own observations, roughly half of my colleagues got admitted through method number one, that is without knowing anyone at MIT, and the other half either had some connection to MIT or have been at MIT before. Having said this, admission rates in method number one are actually quite low. Methods number two and three have higher admission rates, but getting there isn't so easy. More about this towards the end of this video. Let's dive right into what you can do to maximize your chances of getting admitted. Professors have the last saying when it comes to PhD applications. They may get a little bit of help from some administrators, but in the end, all good candidates' applications will eventually make it to the desk of a professor who will make a final decision. Therefore, put yourself into their shoes. What does a professor want from a PhD candidate? Well, first of all, they want you to show that you have some prior research experience, And secondly, they want you to be interested in some research area that is both interesting to them and will allow them to file for applications for grant money. How do you convince a professor that you're going to be a great researcher? Well, there exists just one way. You have to have some past research experience, ideally having some publication. It doesn't have to be a first author publication, although that would be a major plus. If you can do research directly at your undergraduate institution, go for it as soon as possible. Unfortunately though, many undergraduate institutions, including mine, do not offer research opportunities for undergraduate students. Sadly though, this will not get you excused from getting research experience. I myself had to really fight for it. I ended up doing climate science research in Denmark, then machine learning research in San Diego in California, and after that I did research in quantum computing in Singapore. All of this was paid for by different scholarships that I also had to really fight for. Also, once you get such research opportunities, make sure to do your absolute best. I personally worked between 60 and 80 hours per week during these research internships because I knew that this was my only chance to really stand out. I ended up publishing 7 papers before my application deadline, one of them as a first author, and 2 more publications before my PhD actually started. Although, don't panic, because most of my colleagues at MIT published only between 1 and 3 publications before they started. Also, as a side note, the people you end up doing research with are ideal candidates to write your letters of recommendations. So even if you don't publish something together with them, they might still get you really, really far. Next up, how do you convince a professor that your research is both interesting and will get a lot of funding? Well, when choosing and looking for your first research project, you should definitely look for something that's both hot at the moment and currently gets a lot of funding already. Then, a few months before applications are due, make sure to look at every single professor in the department that you're applying to and ask yourself, A, is their current research interesting to you? And B, do you have any experiences or skills that they might deem relevant? If you find one or more professors that check both of these boxes, then, and only then, you should carefully go ahead and draft a very good email that is specifically written for them. Also, as a little bonus tip, you might consider reaching out to PhD candidates working with these professors. PhD candidates tend to receive far fewer emails than professors and are therefore much more likely to actually respond to you. Here are a few examples of some emails that I received recently. The email on the right was clearly sent to hundreds of people. He didn't say my name, he just said your research, your organization, so it was clearly just copy-pasted to many, many people. The one on the left is great though. It is clear that he did thorough research about me online by the fact that he brings up some research that I worked on in the past. Next, he expresses my current topic of research, and he must have noticed that I stopped publishing papers on hyperdimensional computing and started working on neural networks for quantum computers. Great catch. Next, he lists research experience that could come in really handy when working with me. And lastly, he mentions that he's a fan of my YouTube channel, a personal project of mine that I'm passionate about, so great catch. He must have spent at least 1 hour writing this, so I know exactly that he didn't just go around and spam every single person. Such an email has the highest likelihood of success. Usually, when you get a reply, professors will either tell you that they're interested, but will only really consider you once they actually get admitted, or that they currently do not have any funding to support new PhD students in that area. Either way, don't get discouraged because this is really useful information that you can use in the next step. Writing your statement of purpose. There are many great videos talking about everything in detail, so I'm just going to focus on everything high level here. So you should pick a few professors that you would like to work with. Make sure that all of them satisfy the both requirements that I told you about before. If you emailed them before, you can take this information to your advantage. For example, if they told you that they like your background, there's a good chance that when you apply, they would actually hire you. And on the other hand, if they said they currently don't hire PhD students, either in general or maybe just for your specific area, then there's just no point in even mentioning them in your statement of purpose. Next up, make sure to clearly write about your research interests in your statement of purpose. Make sure to do some research and write about specific fields that are currently researched by the professors you want to work with. I'm not saying you have to make up and lie exactly what you want to work on, but for example, if you're interested in gravity, there's a professor that researches quantum gravity, which is kind of a subfield of this, then you know, why not also express interest about that specific subfield? If you write, for example, that you want to explore differential geometry, but there's not a single professor in the whole department working on this, you will most likely not get admitted, even if you're super smart. Also, don't forget that you're applying for a research position. So telling about your big plans of starting a $1 billion company will probably not really help you. I applied to Caltech for research in quantum algorithms. I even personally met the professors who makes the final decision about which candidates get hired in this specific area. He was super excited about working with me, but unfortunately Caltech only takes between 0 and several candidates each year in a specific field. And unfortunately the year I applied, it just so happened to be 0 candidates. So I didn't get admitted. But the good thing is at least I know that I did absolutely everything I could possibly do in order to maximize my chances of getting admitted, even if it didn't work out. So far we talked about how important research is for your application, as well as finding professors who have enough funding to support you. Next, let us talk about some other factors that really matter for a PhD application. For undergraduate applications in the US, it is very important that you show that you are a very diversely talented person. For example, volunteering, sports competitions, science and math competitions, or just anything else really matters for these applications. For PhD applications, unfortunately, this isn't so important because it's all about specializing into doing research. Next up, let us talk about grades. So grades are kind of important for grad school because, especially if you're applying under your undergraduate studies, it kind of shows that you're very dedicated to the field of research that you want to do. The only way to get into MIT or another top school without good grades is if you have some great research to compensate for it. Good results in your GRE. So I think standardized tests overall aren't that important, and if you have good scores, they aren't going to get you admitted. Having said that, if you have bad scores, it might be a big red flag on your application and might actually get you rejected. MIT didn't require me to take the GRE, so I didn't do it, but I think it also wouldn't have made sense for me in general because preparing for it would have just taken so much time. I think the only way that it really makes sense for you to take a GRE is if you are from some kind of school system that is very far away from the US, so I don't know, maybe a developing country or a lesser known university or something like that. In that case, it might just make sense to have something standardized to show that you're really good. Lastly, let me talk about something that you've probably been waiting for throughout the whole video, that is how to get admitted through methods number 2 and 3. That is how to get admitted through some connection at MIT or through having stayed there in some way. Obviously, this is the very best of applying because it significantly boosts your chances of getting admitted. Unfortunately, though, professors at top-tier universities tend to work with other professors at top-tier universities. So if you're not at a top-tier university already, this might be a bit tricky. For example, me being at MIT, I mostly interact with professors and students from Harvard, Caltech, Berkeley, ETH Zurich, and other very known schools. But before I came to MIT, while I studied in a lesser known university, I only knew one professor who actually had a connection to MIT, and he was working in a field that just wasn't really interesting to me. At the same time, some of my friends who studied at, for example, ETH Zurich, had a much easier time of getting admitted because they worked with professors who were best buddies with MIT professors. But don't worry about this. If you do not have the connections or know someone, just make sure to put a lot of extra effort into networking, and sooner or later you're going to find someone to help you. Remember, 50% of my colleagues at MIT got admitted without knowing anyone there, so don't worry too much about it. Having said all of this, I've also never met anyone at MIT who wasn't truly exceptional. So even if you have the best connections to MIT, unless you're truly exceptional and have someone who is going to personally vouch for you to be great, you're not going to get admitted. Just to give you an example of this, my group works very closely together with Google Research. Everyone there respects and knows my advisor, and they are one of the best groups in the world for quantum computing. So if someone in my group wants to work and do an internship with Google Research, all that has to happen is my advisor needs to give them a call and has to personally vouch for that person to be great. The problem though is if I do not do a good job with my advisor and he's unhappy with me, he's surely not going to personally vouch for me to be good because that would put his reputation at stake. Therefore, I still have to do an exceptional job in order to get into Google Research. If you're curious about how a typical day in my life as an MIT PhD student looks like, you can click over here. And if you would like to know more about what I actually do for my PhD, you can click over here. If you found this video useful, please give it a thumbs up and you can subscribe to my channel. Well, I guess somewhere down here. I wish you best of luck with your PhD applications. I know this is a super stressful time. I also personally didn't enjoy it, but it's going to work out somehow for you. Thank you so much for watching, and I'll see you next time. Goodbye.